So many of you probably thought science was so boring. You know, you walk in with your lab coat, you have your pipette and your petri dish, and then you're hearing all these stories that Carl's talking about. It really is. Science is very much sort of a drama sitcom as much as anything else. But all of this work, all of the, you know, sometimes manipulations, the sort of going after grants, it's so that we can shove, we shove our work into these journals. And a lot of times we'll do basically anything to get into these high prestige journals. So why should you as...
I have to interrupt you for a second, just as a spur of the moment remark. When you said that, there's a lovely paper in economics written recently called My Left Arm for a Publication in the AER. And the AER is the American Economic Review, which is their, you know, top journal, Cell Nature. And they use these methods that you use to, that economists use to determine appropriate compensation for workplace limb injury. And they found that the average economist would be willing to give up a thumb in order to get a paper in the AER, which is astonishing if you think about it. But it can make a huge difference. It can make
that, was that the mean though? Was that the average?
Oh, so hell, I don't know. I'm gonna go sit down.
So this particular slide, you're sort of you're ready to graduate from the University of Washington. You're probably wondering, why do I care at all about scholarly publishing? The reason why you should care, because that's the packaging that you're going to be able to tell when you go into the real world and you eventually land onto some primary literature, the science literature. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. Now, the other thing about the scholarly publishing world, it's a big, big industry. The STM is the Science, Technology, and Medicine Publishing Group in the world. It's the largest of these international organizations that houses some of the biggest publishers in the world. They house two-thirds of all the scientific publishing, this organization, of publishers, and annually they bring in about $9 billion in revenue. That's big. Actually, just at the University of Washington, can anyone guess what the budget is for collections? So collections is books and journals, but it's mostly journals. Can anyone just put in your head, how big do you think that is? Just at our university, how much do we pay out? It's around $17 million for collections. Much bigger than even paying all the employees in the building and probably the heat and the building itself. If you sold the building, it would be more. But the collections is a really big part of the budget. Publishing costs money. To package content, to organize peer review, to make it available, to curate it, it's an expensive endeavor to get our scientific knowledge out there. The big thing that we keep telling you is to consider the source, consider the source, consider the source. And where we are in the eighth week of this class is having you consider the source of journals. Now, if you run into an article in the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times or a local newspaper that points to some scientific article, and it's something in Nature or Science, it doesn't mean that that particular science article is truth. But you could at least be certain there was a pretty substantial peer review process that particular paper went through. And, you know, there are good articles and there's bad articles, but the reputation that Nature has built over the last several hundred years gives you some confidence. But right now, over the last decade, it's been going on for more than a decade, but it's really accelerated over the last decade, you've started to see many, many more of these very, niche journals. This isn't a real journal, by the way, but we were just sort of making it up. But West Tennessee Journal of Bug Farming, it doesn't mean that in this particular journal there would be anything, that they wouldn't produce good science, but in these kinds of journals, you should be a little bit suspect if you see big claims in these journals. We'll talk a little bit about that more today. And also just, excuse me, in general, you want to be a little suspect of some of these particular types of journals we're going to talk about today called predatory journals. So the title of this particular lecture this week is on predatory publishing. That'll help you evaluate that. Now, Carl and I, for the last decade, have been working on ways to try to automate the process, build tools for scientists and the general public to try to discern between high-quality journals and maybe not as high-quality journals. So we've built several tools and metrics through this project we call Eigen Factor, which led to a bunch of other interesting work, but sort of the core mission at the time was to try to figure out a way of measuring influence within science. During this time that Carl and I have been working on this particular project, Eigen Factor, there's been this acceleration of this new kind of publishing in science. It's called open access. For those of you that are computer scientists, you can appreciate the sort of equivalent open access movement in open source software. In scientific publishing, it's similar. The idea is I produce some sort of research report or research paper, and I want to make it available to the general public. The traditional form of publishing for the last several hundred years is that the libraries would pay for it, and there would be a paywall. So that work that I did isn't necessarily available unconstrained by the paywalls and other kinds of constraints. So the exact, there are people quibble about the exact definition of open access. But from your standpoint, you can think of it as science research available without constraints or any sort of paywalls. Now, there are organizations like the NIH, the National Institute of Health, that are now mandating that anything that's funded by your tax dollars have to be available within a one-year embargo. So there's all sorts of big changes going on. The idea is that we think science will run better if that kind of information is available. Now, there's been lots of cute cartoons and videos and papers written about this open access movement for the general public and for science itself. And this one, this PhD Comics version, is a nice for if you're interested in trying to understand this open access movement, you can go watch this particular video. The idea, though, is it is growing. So Nature wrote an article recently showing this growth in open access using the Scopus database. They basically looked at the worldwide share of these papers that make these open these articles open. So the red here is immediately open, so journals can make it immediately open. You have the yellow, which is immediately hybrid. Hybrid is a mix between two different types of articles. We'll talk about it. It's sort of a mix of author pay and subscription based. And you have these delayed open access that have these embargoes. But the point here is that it is growing. This open content that's now available to the world as soon as, well, not always right when the research is finished, but we'll just consider it this open access subset, is growing. The numbers right now, according to the Directory of Open Access Journals, we have around 9,000 OA journals. Again, let's say you're working at a company and you're given some study that you're supposed to evaluate for your company as to whether it's real or not real, and you run into an open access journal. It doesn't mean that it's a bad journal. There's many open access journals that are really good, but in this subset we'll talk about here in just a second, where you can run into it, it becomes more complicated. Not that subscription-based journals are always problem-free, but at least understand in the publishing world that there's open access journals and non-open access journals. And of those, there's about 2.5 million articles that are open for reading and building upon. So the typical world of scientific publishing has been the subscription-based. Again, this is where the libraries pay, and there typically is a paywall. Again, it's complicated. There's good science in this version and there's bad science, and just in open access you'll find bad papers and good papers. Now, the predominant model that's driving a lot of the open access, driven mostly by the Public Library of Science, PLOS, and their subset of journals, instead of the librarians paying for it, I pay for it as an author. So when I go do my research, I write up the paper, and then I write a check, if it gets accepted, to PLOS. So think about that for a second. I write a check to PLOS if it gets through peer review. Maybe you'll start to see the subtleties of this problem. Now, there are big organizations like our local, one of the biggest foundation, basically the biggest foundation in the world here, locally in Seattle, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, recently made an announcement that circled around the world of publishing and science, and just outside of science, it's in the regular newspapers, that said that anything we fund has to be open access. For the most part, I think that's a really, really good thing. This also is in line with this NIH mandate that I mentioned that requires things to be open. In economics, in a commodity market, you typically, if I was Ford, the way that the flow of money and goods sort of go in opposite directions. So if I was Ford and I wanted to build cars, I go ask the United States Steel Association to send me some steel metals. I build the car. after I build the car, consumers pick up the car at the car dealership, send money to Ford, and then Ford sends money to United States Steel Association. This is a typical economic market. Let me tell you something about publishing. It's a little different market. So scientists slave over their work. They write. They spend years and years publishing and working out a problem that they hope the world will care about. They send it to the publishers. The publishers package it and curate it, organize peer review. They send it to the University of Washington Library. The University of Library sends money to the publishers, and then the flow starts to change. This is pretty good for publishers in this author pay, where authors in these kind of strange markets, they'll pay to get published, and they have the same thing where the libraries are paying for it too.